Airline Pilot Guy, episode number 77. Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, the view from my side of the cockpit door. I'm Captain Jeff, your host, broadcasting live from Studio 8809 of the Marriott Hotel in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. In this episode, a person-to-person interview with Thomas Salme, the fake pilot. Plus, some of your feedback and questions and whatever else we can squeeze in here. So, get all settled in, tray tables and seat backs in their upright and locked positions, electronic devices powered on. Flight 77 is ready for pushback. Okay, as I said in the beginning, this show is mostly going to be the interview that I did, well, not mostly, but a big part of it will be the interview that I did with the fake pilot, Thomas. But before I do that, I need to take care of some administrative matters. And as usual, I made some mistakes on the last episode and probably some before that. Probably a lot more than I know, but I was mentioning or talking about somebody that asked about the name Super, like the Super 80, etc. And I thought that that was something that American Airlines had used to market the airplane. But according to my friend Super Dave MC, a little suspicious, isn't it? He says the term was actually a marketing name from McDonnell Douglas for the DC-9 and DC-8 stretches as well. He says somewhere I've got some pictures. If I can find them, he'll send them to me. So thank you, David, for keeping me straight, Mr. Super Dave. Talking about the Super MD, the Super 80, and other super appellations, I guess. The other thing I was going to, I have a note here, and I meant to talk about in the previous episode, perhaps before that, that Asiana 214, right? We have a situation where passengers are just flying along and aren't thinking of negative things at all, and then all of a sudden that horrific impact with the seawall and the near cartwheeling airplane going down the runway, the pirouetting airplane, and coming to a stop. And then just last week, the Southwest Airlines 737 at LaGuardia coming in to land. It looks like a pretty nice day looking out the window, and then all of a sudden, boom, we're in a situation where the airplane seems to be out of control or something is going terribly wrong. And so my point here is that always expect or try to expect the unexpected. And with that in mind, next time, or just think about it right now, imagine yourself sitting in an airplane. And what I want you to do is I want you to look down at your feet. Okay? What are you wearing on your feet? Are you wearing those very stylish slingbacks or open-toed shoes, ladies or men? Are you wearing something more practical that covers the whole foot? Let's move up a little bit. Wearing short shorts or shorts at all? Are you dressed like you're going to the beach? Just something to consider. You know, what happens if you put yourself in that Asiana 214? Put yourself in the Southwest Airlines 737 and any other flight that has had an evacuation event, okay? Think about what you're wearing, and is that going to be something you really want to be wearing at that time, okay? So I know we all want to, we're all going on our vacations, and we're going from somewhere maybe cold or going to somewhere that it's nice and warm like the Caribbean or whatever. I want to be already dressed for the climate before I even leave wherever I'm leaving from. And I'm just saying that that may not be the best idea, just something to consider. Think about maybe wearing something more practical in case you are involved in another Asiana 214 or Southwest or whatever. Okay. So just something to think about. And here we go.
How much more coffee?
No, thanks.
Thank you very much to those of you who are continuing to contribute to Captain Jeff's Coffee Fund. Those guys always seem to get louder and louder as I start talking about my coffee fund. I don't know, maybe they're jealous. They're not getting any money for the coffee fund, I can tell you that. So, I would like to specifically thank Matthew, Christian, Kevin, and Brian. Thanks very much, all of you, for your contributions. It is appreciated. All right. And the Ink Spots, I appreciate you guys too. Again, that's a recording from the 1940s, not protected by copyright, as far as I can tell. And here I made a little sound effect for this. You hear that? Some dropping going on there? That's the best I could do. I don't think that the Dropbox has any sound effects of their own. So Dropbox, the great file sharing, offline storage, syncing application for your iPhone and or smartphone, tablets, laptops, desktops, etc. I appealed for referrals, or actually I referred you to sign up for Dropbox, and if you used my referral code, as a couple of you did, Kappa or Copa and Willie934, thank you very much, sir. The both of you combined gave me an extra 1 gigabyte of storage, and that's very helpful. So thank you very much. Okay, now let's get on with the point of this episode. Now, you'll remember that a couple episodes ago, or maybe it was last episode, I don't recall exactly. Leonard from Sweden sent me some feedback, and he said, "Hey, do you recall, or have you ever heard of this guy who was flying around for 13 years over here in Europe without proper documentation, et cetera, and it finally caught up with him, they arrested him, blah, 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 and can that ever happen in the United States?" And you remember my answer. So I think I talked about this in the beginning of the interview. Well, anyway, I was contacted by Thomas, and we got together. Turns out I had a layover in Miami at the same time. That's where he is in the U.S. right now. And I said, why don't we get together and do an interview? So without further ado and without further repeating myself, let's hear my interview from the lobby bar at the hotel in Miami. Here we go. I'm here in Miami, Florida, and you'll remember that it wasn't that long ago that somebody sent me some feedback. Leonard, is that the way you would pronounce his name?
Leonard. Correct, Leonard.
Okay. Leonard. Oh, that even sounds better. Like Leonard. Ah, okay.
Leonard
sent me some feedback and asked me about if I'd heard of this man in Sweden, a Swedish man, who had flown for 13 years without a license and got caught and the whole thing. And I said, well, I kind of remember that. And so I looked up this man on the Wikipedia, and I saw a Wikipedia article about him. His name is Thomas Salme. And so I answered the question on episode number 73, I think, something like that. And then just about a week ago or so, I received an email from somebody, and the somebody was Thomas Salme. Am I saying your last name correctly?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
And so he said, hey, I'd heard that you were, you know, answering some questions about me, and I'm going to be in the States. I'm going to be in Miami for about a month or so, like in a couple weeks. And so if you want to get together and do an interview or something like that, you know, that'd be great. And I said, well, that would be kind of cool. And so we were coordinating this. And I said, well, I got a trip that leaves on this day, and then I go back out again. And I went, wait a minute, I have a Miami layover. And so I excitedly sent another email to Thomas and said, hey, I'm going to be in Miami. If your schedule allows, why don't we just get together and have a beer and just do a quick interview? So I'm here in the lobby of our hotel, the Hilton in Miami, and I have with me in person, in the flesh, Thomas.
The bad guy.
Yeah, well, you know, okay, so you heard my answer when somebody asked about, you know, what do you think about this whole thing? Could it happen in the United States? And I kind of gave my thoughts on it. And so let's start from the beginning, not the beginning, but early on, like most of us, most of the people that listen to my show, and like me, usually at some early age, like for me, I think it was around like 10 years old or something like that, going to the Los Angeles International Airport and smelling the smell of jet fuel exhaust and seeing the airline pilots walking through the concourse, I thought, this is what I want to do. I want to fly airplanes for a living. And was that kind of this? How did you get interested in flying? And
well, I think it's the, you take my words more exactly, you know, how I felt. You know, I was, of course, not in America. I was in Sweden. So I went with my father when I was, I think, 8 or 9 years old. And I went to Stockholm Arlanda Airport on a picnic because he was like a semi-professional photographer. And we went outside the terminal and close to the runway. And we started to take photos. And that's what first time I saw, you know, those beautiful colored aircrafts, airliners. So since that time, you know, 8 or 9 years old, I wanted to be an airline pilot. So, yep. You know, the smell together with the colors and also the imagination, where is this aircraft going to New York?
Oh, yeah, the travel, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. To see the world.
That's exotic.
Exactly, it's exotic. It's something, you know, to get out from where you are, you know, to, mm-hmm. to see the world.
Right.
That
right.
feeling, you know. And since then, you know, I was like more and more passionate, you know, and getting to read about it and to build Lego, you know, Lego, mm-hmm. build aircrafts. And, you know, my life was about flying since that.
Right. Yeah, I still remember playing. I always had some kind of little model airplane that I would be, yeah. you know, like holding in my hand and pretending that I was flying the thing and landing it. And yeah.
Exactly. I mean, it's basically that some, you know, many young people, such boys maybe, they want to be, you know, or a firefighter, or, you know, they want to be an airline pilot. So I think that was like many other, but the difference
sure.
that, you know, I was hard-headed and I did a different way than other people, than you did.
Okay, so back when I'm a kid and want to do this, the only resource I have available to me to learn about flying, other than just knowing people who are pilots, is like buying Flying Magazine. I've mentioned that I got a subscription to Flying Magazine, I think, when I was 12 years old, and I was reading all these articles and really had no idea what I was reading, and over time I started kind of absorbing more and more. But you grew up in a time frame where we had personal computers.
Well, it was at the beginning of PC computers. I'm born 1969, so I'm 44 years old now. So yeah, we had in the beginning, there was no internet, of course, at that time when I was young, but there was books, of course, going to the library, getting books, American books, you know, or once now and then magazines that I could have from a shop in Stockholm, that imported from America. That was what, you know, the big things that mm-hmm. I started to learn. But then a lot of things that I think helped me was to fly the Microsoft Flight Simulator, mm-hmm. which was, you know.
So at what age were you when you started, you know, using Microsoft? Because a lot of listeners to the Airline Pilot Guy show are Microsoft Sim or X-Plane Simulator.
Yeah.
That's their world, and they've learned how to fly by doing the simulation.
Well, I know I tested the latest versions. They are really accurate, you know, and even, you know, I was started with the first one. I think it was called FS4. It was an RGB monitor, mm-hmm. and I was like maybe 12 years old, 13 years old. RGB, no color, and, you know, no graphic, basically. You know, it was a Learjet, so you you have to simulate, you know, but it was like with VRs. It was very like basic, but you still have to think, imagining everything in your head. So it's on like instrument flying basic. It's, it was quite good, I think. But then, you know, I even used it, you know, before get, even when I got my job as a pilot, I even used it. And then, you know, flew flights, you know, training myself.
Okay, so you'd say like, well, I might have to fly from Milan to this city, and so you can do the profile in the simulator?
Yeah, exactly. You could do the ILS, and you know, and basically just flying as much as possible, you know, because I like it as well, you know. And,
right. Did you have the like the control stick and any other?
I had a joystick.
Okay.
So I did not have the control stick, but it was quite advanced computer, and the graphic card was great.
Yeah.
And I mean, Microsoft did a great job.
Yeah. Yeah.
Definitely. I mean, I'd even flew, you know, from London or Amsterdam sometimes to Hong Kong.
Wow.
You know, I was there. Yeah, I was there, and I prepared food, and I went to bed, and I woke up, and the sun.
Really?
Was
up. So like real time.
Yeah. Exactly.
Wow.
And it was really well done by, you know, because the sound went up at that time, you know.
Uh-huh.
It was really well done.
Wow. So, okay, so you're about 12, 13, somewhere in there when you started doing that.
Exactly.
And as things advanced, as they got new versions of it, you fly the new versions of it and everything else. So you go through what we call high school. You probably call it something different in Sweden.
Yeah, gymnasium, yeah.
Gymnasium. By the way, backing up a little bit. You grew up, originally you were from from Estonia?
No. My father is...
Oh, okay. So you grew up in...
I grew up, I'm born in Stockholm.
Okay.
And I'm suburban, which is a suburban very famous. It's called Jordbro, which means Earth Bridge, which was very famous, still famous for being a bad place. Criminal. And when I grew up, there was a lot of people from different ethnics, Yugoslavian, Turkish people, and Finnish people, and in the beginning, of course, you were afraid, but then in the end of my grown up in this place was something positive, because it's also something that connects me to be a pilot, because I see different cultures.
Right.
You know, you go home to your friend who's from Yugoslavia and eats food, and you know they are very nice. They're not like you thought they were. You know, so. In fact, something bad gave me something positive in there.
Right. Okay. So you go through gymnasium, and then toward the end there, you're heading to the military?
Well, no. Well, first of all, my 1 week before I got examined in the school, my mother dies of cancer. That's, of course, you know, like all, you know, losing your mother at that age is not fun.
No.
And that was a very big drama for me, and... my father, after a year, he found another one, and I started the military, but I did not feel that I could accomplish it. I felt really bad, so I asked for a postponement, you know, and they said, okay, no problem, you can do that, you can, because I told them, you know, my mother died, it just happened 6 months before the military.
Okay. Was your idea going into the military, so at a young age, you were thinking, I want to be an airline pilot, did you kind of know about, like, the different routes to get there, or?
Well, in Sweden at that time there was, you could do it military, but now in Sweden military wise, you know, it was a small country, we're not NATO, and I did not have an interest, so I did not think, okay, be a military pilot and then be an airline pilot, that was, so I did not even think about being, it was not my interest.
Yeah.
We had a school, that was the school to be, like, you know, you have to pay yourself. No, 99% of the people, they went to the States to make to get
their training.
Yeah, the training, and then get back, convert a license, and then fly. At that time, I had some money inherited from my mother, so I started pilot flight school in Sweden to get a private license.
That's, so you did get your private pilot's license,
and that's where it stopped.
Yeah,
I stopped, and I got. I did not have money.
Yeah.
I could not get a loan because I could not, my father, I was not living with my father anymore, I was out on my own, and that's where it stopped. And in Sweden the regulation was that you had to have a certain amount of hours every year to keep it. So after 1 year I was finished, I did not even have it after 1 year. So 4 or 5 years passed, my dream was still to be a pilot. And I tried music. I did not make it, and I did some photography.
So it was like, you still wanted to be a pilot, but it was like, you kind of knew that I don't have the resources to do it.
Exactly.
So I'm going to do something else.
Exactly. And I tried, and I thought that I could, like, okay, leave this, forget about this.
Right.
But it was so strong feeling. It was inside me.
Yeah.
So after 4 or 5 years, trying with music and doing a little bit different works and trying and having no success because I was playing music, and then I could not be like some of my friends that are working. I was working with Britney Spears, Backstreet Boys, produced by Swedish, with my, some of my friends, Christian and the other guys. And comparable to them, I felt that I could not make it.
Right.
So
it's a tough, it's
yeah,
a tough
you have
business.
You have to have talent there as well. And yeah. I felt that I did not have that comparable to them.
Right.
So, well, the feeling of the being pilot still had there. So after 4 or 5 years, like in a point of time, being lucky, I just called out the SS Flight Academy, where they have these big simulators. And I told them, listen here, I'm a pilot, I don't have a job, my name is Thomas Salme, can I come and fly in the evening, in the midnight? Because that's when I understand that they do maintenance, they do. Mm-hmm. And the guy was surprised and said, yeah, come over. That's basically
so
how
it was.
It
like,
started.
Did you know this guy? Or
No.
Oh, okay.
I just called up and, you know, said, hi, my name, and I think that nobody has ever done that before. So
right.
He was like shocked. He did not say no. He said, all right, you know, nobody calls him, you know, it never happened in Sweden before.
Yeah.
And Sweden is not, you know, not a dangerous country, not
right.
terrorism. So, you know, he was like, okay, come over. And he gave me an MD-80 mm-hmm. to sit in there. And I remember that he said, okay, which airport shall I put you on? Because he, you know, program it.
Mm-hmm.
Shall I put you on Stockholm or Copenhagen? Or I said, no, give me KJFK. Give me New York John F. Kennedy. Because that's one of the big, you know, my dreams, you know?
Right.
So
this was back in the mid-90s?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
About 95.
Okay.
So he put me there. And I was in a MD-80, New York John F. Kennedy simulator,
mm-hmm.
doing nothing. Just looking at all the instruments. I'm very happy.
Yeah.
So that's how it started. And then I got back. I got to know the guy, you know, and I called him now. Then I always put him on his back. I cleaned, you know, and I left.
Mm-hmm.
And he felt that he could rely on me on one way. So I created like kind of a relationship with him.
Right.
I didn't do anything bad. I get some chocolates for him sometimes, you know. And
so what were you doing in the meantime to support yourself?
Well, I was working at different. I was working at a Blockbuster video store,
mm-hmm.
and the music gave me a little bit of money.
Yeah.
And I had those, you know, I was working as an audio technician in the company, those jobs during daytimes.
Okay.
So, but during the nights, I went there.
But so how often would you do that?
I
maybe
would say
like
that
once every couple of weeks or something?
No, I would say that would maybe, because it was not on a regular basis, because also he was not working, you know, of course.
Right,
whatever.
Right.
I think maybe in one year and a half, I was there maybe 15, 20 times.
Okay. So maybe about an average about a month, every month or so. But
A couple of times every month, maybe. Sometimes three times.
So in between, you were also studying.
I was studying metrology. I was studying, I get to borrow from him the manuals to copy.
Okay.
Of the, you know,
the aircraft manuals.
Yes, AUMs was
mm-hmm.
volume 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
So I took that, and I copied and started studying. And of course, you know, electrical system and hydraulics, and you know, this was on the MD-80. So, and I got to.
He probably knows more about it than I do.
I forget. I know that the trim stabilizes motion, you know. And I sometimes even brought some friends with me, you know. And
yeah.
Chris, and one of my friends, who's a very famous now musician. Producing music,
yeah.
you know.
Well, he probably, when you were telling him you were flying a simulator, he probably said, no way.
No, but he thought that I was a pilot, because he said,
oh, okay.
So he came with me, he said, okay. I said, I know this guy, you can fly me. He thought, you know, and I said, so he was like there, wow. And he asked me, you know, he asked me a question, because he was interested, you know.
Okay.
But that's like, you know, more like that. So we flew together sometimes. I brought some friends, and, you know, of course, I felt that I was more and more prepared. Mm-hmm. So it came today, you know, I said, I just want to prove my see how what an airline thinks about me. Mm-hmm. So I saw that they were looking for jobs in Italy. Air One, Italian airline, 737. At that time, I had also flew some in the same on the 73 with SAS. So both of them have been flying.
Okay.
And I just made a false CV, putting airlines like Aladdin Airlines.
Is that like a resume?
Yeah, CV. Okay. Like a resume, you know, saying that I've been flying with the Aladdin Airlines, an airline that I just, you know, fantasized.
You made up, yeah. Kind of like the airline that I fly for, Acme.
Yeah.
That's the my made-up airline.
Ah, you see? Mm-hmm. So my made-up airline, put them, I had some hours and sent it in, and I was called up for an interview. No, first for a simulator test.
Now, so are you surprised that you get a response when you put that you flew for Aladdin Airlines? I mean, didn't you think that someone would go, what airline?
Yeah, no, it wasn't even in my mind. I was thinking, well, you know, I just put them. I did not think yes or no at that time.
Yeah.
I did not think about the paperwork. I just, you know.
Yeah.
It was, you know, I did not think if they're going to believe it or not. But I was, of course, a little bit surprised in a positive way I was when they called me.
Yeah.
To do the simulator test.
Yeah.
So I went to Dublin because the Air One in Italy did not have a 737 simulator. We went to Dublin. There was an airline captain from Air One, Giuseppe, the flight operation. He was a training chief of training. Another air captain and me was applying for a co-pilot job. And, well, 4 hours, engine fires, land crosswinds and everything. And after that, he said, well, Thomas, you passed it. Welcome to Italy if you want to. So I went home and I was happy. And the funny thing, I can't tell you too much now because it's going to be long, too much. But the funny thing that Italy at that time was very bureaucratic. I remember that I had to have all my school grades translated by official translator to Italian and then go to the embassy and get the stamps from there, but not my license. So basically another month later, I went down to Rome with about $100 and I started my career.
So when you applied to Air One, obviously you had to have something that looked like a license. So
I made my own license.
Okay.
Which now after 13 years, when they caught me, the police found out that it was misspelled in mm-hmm. Swedish and in English, because I used maybe a word, no Photoshop, very, you know, and I cut it out with a scissor.
Uh-huh. Right. Not like today where anybody can make something look
perfect. No, that was very perfect. It was very a bad copy.
Yeah.
Because it was, and there was a space in the license that stamp. Not mm-hmm. because I did not have a stamp, I left it open.
Yeah.
And nobody checked it.
Wow. Okay. So kind of fate, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So you go to Rome. You have $100 in your pocket, and you start off your career as an airline pilot.
Yeah.
And you fly with them for 2-3 years before you get to a position to upgrade.
2.5 years, and then I become a captain, selection of the company, and then I'm married and I have a kid.
So let's back up a little bit.
Yeah.
Because you're telling me about, I get to see it on your face, the excitement when you first got into that real airline simulator, and you didn't even do anything until the next time, and you started doing more and more things. So now you've been hired by a real airline, and you're in Rome, and you start your first trip. Was that something you were apprehensive about or stressed out about? Like,
well, the feeling when. Of course, when I get down to Rome, there's a company course, so you know, for the regulations, and I got mm-hmm. more manuals, which is good because I can study,
yeah.
And I got the uniform, so I think it's a matter of 2 weeks or so. After that, they sent me up to Milan, and my first flight is from Milan to Naples, so. And the feeling I had was, of course, I'm nervous, but nervous, I want to be a good pilot.
Yeah.
I want to do my job. And maybe, you know, I don't speak perfect English, I'm Swedish, but comparable to that at that time to the, with Italians. My favorites, I speak very good English to comparable to the Italians.
Right.
So taking off from Milan, I'm a co-pilot.
And you're at the controls.
I'm non-pilot flying. So the captain is flying first leg. So it's Milan to Naples. He's flying. I'm doing the radio and you know, the paper. So the radio, of course, it went well, you know?
Yeah.
Because I've been training that since I was 10 years old with the flight radio and everything. So that was not a problem. Going down to Naples and then going back again. Now it's my turn. And I'm not nervous because I think I will be discovered that time. I think I'm less worse because it's my first job, you know, it's my... So I want to be behaved.
You know, I was nervous the very first time that I was at the controls of a real airliner for a real, you know, and have passengers in the back. And, well, actually, I was in the Air Force, so I had some big transport flying. But I still remember the first time I was in a real airplane for the first time actuating the controls. And how exciting that was, and how thrilling that was.
Yes,
same thing for you, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I was like amazed. I mean, I just was concentrating myself. Okay, and you know, because 737, I had experience from the sim. It looks the same, and the procedures a little bit company based, but the checklists were the same. And you know, and when I took the controls and taking off, you know, great.
Mm-hmm.
And then you know, cruising this flight with the autopilot, and you know, I remember that she said, okay. 8,000 feet or something, okay, Thomas, disconnect everything, you know, and this radio vectors, and it was not the best landing, but it was not even close to a crash. So, I mean, it was, and I remember that time I went home to the hotel, I was staying in a hotel, and I had like 3 or 4 days of intensive flying training. I was very tired, because I went back and I studied and everything.
Right. You know. You probably weren't getting a lot of sleep.
No. But after 3 or 4 days, we had like 2 or 3 days off. And that was the time that I felt I made it. I made my first, you know, step into the aviation as a pilot. And it was a good feeling. I was happy because it was my dream. But also, on the other hand, it was also like a bad feeling because I knew I was lying.
Mm-hmm.
I was hiding something.
You're kind of living a lie.
Yeah. So it was like I felt lonely.
Yeah.
I could not tell anybody. I could tell them, you know, I got the job, but I could not tell anybody the secrets.
So you meet your wife.
A couple of months later, yeah.
And so you get married, and you have children.
Correct.
And you didn't share that the secret at all with them.
I did.
As far as they knew,
I was a pilot.
You were a pilot. And you had all the qualifications and everything.
I did not tell anybody about this because it was a secret that became heavier and heavier to have.
What about your dad? He knew. No,
yeah, but I mean, the relationship with my father, when I got the job, he was happy. Oh, but he did not say, but you know, never studied.
Yeah.
Because I was out from him for a couple of years when my
mother
died.
So, there, yeah, you'd separated a little bit.
Yes, and he thought, well, you know, okay, if he's got license, he's a pilot.
Wow.
You know?
Okay. So you upgrade to captain, and you fly for another number of years.
9 years in Air One.
Okay, total. And then you made a change from, as we were saying before we started this interview, in the United States, and I just assumed it was the same for most other countries, but apparently not. If I decided I wanted to, because I've been a captain now at Acme for, I don't know, 12, 13 years, about half of my career. If I wanted to go with a different airline, I couldn't start off as a captain. I'd have to start off from the bottom seniority number and work my way up. And so I thought it was kind of odd, like, why would you, after 9 years of seniority with Air One, why would you leave them and go to a different airline?
Well, the thing was that, you know, I have been written.
Okay, yeah, don't, yeah, but, I don't want you to read.
No, but something happened, you know, and it made me change the company.
Okay.
So I changed the company from Air One, after 9 years, to a Turkish-Dutch charter airline, which I had a friend who was a co-pilot there, and he introduced me to the owner, and I was doing the test, and I passed, and, you know,
Of course, because you've been flying captain for 6 years, yes. 6.5 years, and so a total of 9 years. I mean, you have more airline experience than a lot of people.
Yeah, at that time I had, yeah. So, I mean,
to get sure, you're confident.
So I flew a year with that airline, and they had some financial problems. I went to a British company for a year. In that time, I was also a little bit like trying with other, I would be on the 7-4, you know, doing something different, you know.
Yeah.
I was trying with Jade Cargo, and I passed the test there. But they decided, also with other airlines, pilots with me, that decided not to go at that time. Because, and I think it also was the time that they had even a grounded aircraft because of they did not get pilots. Because yeah. So you had to be in China somewhere and, you know, flying 1,000 hours per month. And, you know, I was not keen on doing this.
Mm-hmm.
So I stayed with the British company, went back to Corendon. They got a little bit bigger. I got the base captain position in Amsterdam.
So base captain, for the listeners, is kind of like the one that's kind of in charge of everything at that base?
Yeah, exactly at the base. You know, I was helping to hire the captains and the pilots, the colleagues, mm-hmm. very
kind
small.
Kind of a quasi-administrative position?
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
And flying at the same time.
Exactly.
Okay.
So, I had some ex-captains from Air One, Irish guys that was flying with me there, so I took some people that I knew. And it was quite nice there. I flew 2 years until March.
Of 2010?
2010. I'm on a flight, going to do a night flight from Amsterdam Schiphol to Ankara. And it's night flights, but 4 hours going there, 4 hours and a half coming back. So it's, I think it's about 11 p.m. local time takeoff. So, and had that during that afternoon, I had a bad feeling in the stomach. I don't know why, you know, mm-hmm. you don't believe in, you know, but there it is. I had a bit bad feeling that day.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but anyway, I go to the terminal of Schiphol with my crew, co-pilot, 5 hostess, and just before the gate, there's 4 police officers, 2 civilian and 2 like police dressed as police officers. And they had done something before, random checks, they check your alcohol and the documents. Mm-hmm. It happened before, some now and then, but I don't know, I had a bad feeling. So I asked them, is there something special before going down to the aircraft? They said, no, we're just going to do a routine check of the documents. Okay, I said, no problem. This was aviation police, mm-hmm. Amsterdam. So we went down, went aboard the aircraft, and the first thing they did was the test of the alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
No problem. Then they started with the documents. So I started with my passport, which is real. I started mm-hmm. with medical, which was real. I started with everything, which was real. And then at the end, the license, which was not real. And then one of the police officers, he takes it, looks it like, all it up in the air,
mm-hmm.
and he says...
Like he's looking through it, through the light or something?
Yeah, and he says, there's something wrong here. At that time, I knew that he knew.
Yeah, he already knew that you didn't
that
have
was,
proper
exactly.
documents.
They got to inside.
Somebody had tipped them off.
Exactly.
Okay.
So I said, let's go, can we go to the office and speak? And he did not put the handcuffs on me. He said, yeah, we can do that, no problem. And then we had a like 5-10 minutes car ride, and I said, well, you know, and they were very nice to me. And then we came up to the building, and there was 2 police officers, you know, like integration room. And I took off my tie because it was warm, and you know, like you come home from work, and mm-hmm. I felt bad, I felt afraid.
Yeah.
But I felt very relieved. And they said, well, you know, we have a suspicion that you don't have a valid license. So I said, well, it's a long story. I've been flying for 13 years without license. And they were like, with the mouth open, and they started to call the prosecutor, and they were like, and that was like, they were completely shocked. And so I said, well, I'm going to tell them everything.
So do you think at that point they knew that at that moment you didn't have a valid license, but they had no idea that your entire career was flown without a valid license?
Exactly. They did not know the how deep it was, how big it was.
Yeah.
So they were like shocked. And I remember I was put in prison, you know, under mm-hmm. you know, that night. The second day I went to the police. They were very nice to me. They never put handcuffs on me. I mean, the treatment was very nice. And the 2 police investigators from Amsterdam, they were very nice to me. And I remember they took me to a room. They asked me if I wanted something to eat, if everything was okay. And before they started, there came a man, the boss, the police chief, and he said he wanted to speak with me a couple of minutes. So they said to me, well, Mr. Salme, or Captain Salme, he said, before we start, you know, with all the procedures here, you know, that's a serious crime. Can you just sign here? Because if this is true, what you told there, you know, I just want to have your autograph. And I was, at that time, I was a little bit shocked because I thought that people will spit on me, people will hate me, and you know. And I was shocked by the reaction, positive reaction, you know?
Right, right. So all these years, these 13 years, this is like, as you said, you knew that what you're doing was wrong, and that you had this weight on your shoulders, and every time you got a call from the airline, you thought, okay, this is it. They probably discovered.
Exactly.
And then when this finally happens, in a way, it's almost like a relief, isn't it?
It was the biggest relief I ever, you know.
And did you have any idea that you were going to go this long before somebody discovered that you didn't have proper documentation? Or?
Well, you know, it's nothing that you plan, you know. It's something that, you know, I came in and it's like a train that goes faster and faster. Mm-hmm. So basically, I know that there was a risk to get caught, all during it, and there's a feeling that you have inside. Because it was very easy to figure out, you know, if I had license or not. But also, I also saw the locals, you know, how the airlines, you know, it was not only an Italian airline, it was a British airline, it was a Dutch airline, I was even checked by the German airlines. And so everywhere in Europe, the airlines that I've been flying for and done the tests for, nobody figured out that I did not have a license, which is the basic thing, you know. Nobody checked it, you know.
And it wasn't like you could go, let's say, after you got hired and you've been flying for a few months and then you go, you know what, I really need to make sure I have all the things that I've said I've had. You can't do that.
Exactly. I could. I mean, it crossed my mind. How can I get out of this nightmare?
I want to make this right,
but I can't. How can you do it?
The train has left the station.
Exactly.
You're on the train, and the only thing you can do is either stay on the train for as long as this journey is going to take you, or jump off.
Exactly.
Okay.
And, you know, jump off, you know, well, it was my dream. And I liked it, to be an airplane pilot. You know, I mean, it's a good job, and I loved it, you know. So I didn't want to do jump off. I didn't want it. It was something that I maybe crossed my mind because I had children, you know.
Right.
But I never did it. And my moral point of view was that every time I passed the tests, medical and the simulator checks, if I pass it, then my point of view, I'm a valid pilot, like another guy. So, I mean, that was my point of view.
Now, we talked about that, and people that listen to my show, a lot of them want to be airline pilots or corporate pilots or do flying for a living. They listen to my show and they ask me, how do I do it? And, you know, what's the best way to do it? And it's hard for me sometimes to answer that question because I can tell you the way I did it, but that was back 25 years ago and 30 years ago, and now, today, it's like a different world of how you get to where you're going to go. And for the people that are seriously wanting to do what you did and what I've done, become, you know, do this for a living, what would you say to them?
Don't do what I did, because you can only do it once.
Right.
You know, I don't advise anybody to cheat. But on the other hand, I would say I did a lot of study, and my passion, I never gave up. You know, that part has brought me, you know, to do what I want to do. You know, then the bad part, if you skip that, you know, if somebody had founded me, you know, given me money, I would have used that to train it. You know? So
right.
I mean, and I would have been a pilot.
So like the for you, the persistence, the perseverance was
focused.
Kind of the focus, the goal that you had, and I know what I was going to say. When I was going through, you know, you had to have certain number of hours to be even considered for an interview for an airline. Most major airlines back in the late 80s required you to have a a four-year college degree. And so, but as we've discussed, I don't think that this job requires that you have a college degree. I don't think this job requires that you have all these different things, but airlines use this as a way to discriminate because there's so many people that want to do this. They have to have a way to kind of to get a sense of somebody's ambition and et cetera. And so, obviously, to me anyway, for you to go through the simulators, pass the tests, to get hired, to fly these trips, if there was any point where somebody you were flying with thought that you were not a, you didn't have the ability and capabilities of being a professional airline pilot, they would have said, something's wrong here. But nobody did. So that shows to me that obviously you have some natural talent flying airplanes. And you had a little bit of experience. You mentioned you had the private pilot's license early on when you did have some money to,
Cessna, yeah.
To pay for training. So, and then all the years and years and years of flying the flight simulator on your PC, and then all the years and years of studying magazines and manuals and everything else. You were a self-taught airline pilot, basically.
Yeah, exactly. I would say, make a joke, I'm not, hey, how about you're not a pilot? Well, I'm an aviator.
Mm-hmm.
Because the aviator did not have a license in the beginning.
Right.
Of course, now we live in a society when, you know, you need to be, you know, you need to have a license. And I think it's also very, I would say, I would not try this now, 2013, because maybe I was in the crossover age, you know, when you still can do it, you know. Now it's everything on the computer, you know.
But what's so remarkable to me is that a lot of this happened after September 11th.
Wow. This is something that I've been thinking. This is the bad part here, because can you imagine if me, Thomas Salme here, if I was a, let's say, a suicide guy. I mean, if I was
right.
not happy with my life, and I said, well, I want to kill me and I want to kill thousands, you know, how easy it would have been for me to plan a flight to, let's say, for London or Rome when there was a big football game where there was like 70,000 people there.
Mm-hmm.
Tell the co-pilot, get me water, close the door, and that's crash and that kill 150 people.
Yeah, but you know what? I mean, if, let's say I decide that my life isn't worth living anymore,
yeah.
I could do the same. Any one of the hundreds of thousands of airline pilots out there today could do that. So just because I understand what you're saying, is that the screening process.
Exactly, the control.
Yeah.
That's what I lack of. You know, they never, because it's so easy, just a telephone call or a fax or an email. To civil aviation, is this guy, does he have a license? And the answer is no.
But you went through the same interview process that all of us do when we get hired by an airline. You see a psychiatrist, probably.
Yeah.
I don't know if you
yeah,
did.
In one airline, yes, I did.
Okay. You take these batteries of tests,
yeah.
Some psychological, some
written,
aptitude tests,
yeah.
Written tests, that kind of thing. So it's not like you didn't go through all the normal screening processes. Really, the only thing that you didn't have was the actual real airline transport. Would you have to have an airline transport pilot license or a commercial license?
Yeah, you have to have ATPL.
You have to have the ATPL. Okay. So, I mean, to me, it's obvious that it's not the right way to get there. So I'm not recommending, and neither is Thomas recommending that this is the route to get there, folks. But I think you did prove that you had what it took to be an airline pilot, because you made it and you flew and you were, and by your own reckoning, you were a good pilot.
Well,
you
know,
like
I
a
mean,
borderline pilot. I mean, you were telling me that you actually were among a group of people that were qualified to go into special airports.
Yeah, I flew to two airports in Italy, that was Reggio Calabria, and to Pantelleria, which are two specially category, like C or D, you know,
mm-hmm.
airports, so the company selects you.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, the manual thing, I had a good feeling for the flying, and of mm-hmm. course, it's a lot of luck as well, but the most important is that I never gave up, you know.
Yeah.
And I would also not recommend anybody doing the same, because it's not possible. It's like, you know, you rob a bank in a good way. You know, you can't do it the second time, the same time. You know, it's now,
right.
What I did, you can do it one time.
Right.
And I did, you know, and now I think it's, and as I told you, I don't recommend, because it's not fun to live 13 years with a lie.
Right.
It's not fun.
Right. Exactly.
And so, I'm still ashamed of that, what I did in that life to many people. You know, I feel stupid in one way.
So, do you miss being an airline pilot?
Well, I don't miss when I fly now, I'm in the States here, and when I fly as a passenger, I felt like, I don't feel that, I want to go in the cockpit, I want to fly the aircraft. I feel that I just want to have a comfortable seat, fly as smooth and as possible. And because I think it's, I don't know, maybe it's my dream. I did my dream, and I did it for a long time, and it ended well. It's just a closed chapter for me, you know?
Right.
So I don't feel for, but on the other hand, you know, I got some questions sometimes that, but Thomas, would you fly again if somebody offered you, and never say never again. Yeah. Never say never.
Right.
But for a moment, I'm just satisfied.
Life's still an open book.
Yeah.
So what are you doing now?
Well, now I'm a photographer. And I'm here in Miami doing photos and a small reportage of filming for Italian television. And for Italian, shoot for Italian magazines, Maxim, and we'll show you soccer. So soccer now. So
football, you mean?
Yeah, football. Yeah, exactly. European kind of football. And I've been up to meet some people in LA about maybe upcoming film.
Okay.
And and the book is written now in English, called 13 Years in Heaven, co-written with a Iranian English guy. Very, I like it as it has been, because I cannot write, so I've been telling my story basically like I do to you.
Yeah, I can't write either, that's why I speak. That's why I do a podcast.
So, you know, we'll see. You know, I think it's when I read, when sometimes when I tell my story and about my story, I think it's like I smile, but not of arrogance, because I smile because it's unbelievable that you can do this for 30 years without getting caught. You know?
Right.
2010.
So you were saying earlier that every so often there's a Thomas Salme comes along, and
I think that sometimes in the society, you know, you need a guy that, without hurting anybody or stealing money, but showing that the loopholes, you know, because, you know, aviation, we have the most safest, you know, the aircraft is very high standard, you know, expensive, and the insurance, and it's, everything is controlled, even as passenger, the security screen, but still, I could, I could fly without the license.
Right.
And also, I mean, hopefully now they covered it all with it.
But obviously, you didn't do this whole thing to reveal the weaknesses in the system.
No, exactly.
You did it because you had a passion for flying.
Yeah.
And for you, that was the way to get there.
Exactly.
And then, as we mentioned earlier, that you were on board that train when it left the station, and it just kept getting faster and faster and faster. The journey kept getting longer and longer, and you just stayed on it for as long as you could.
Yeah, exactly. Until it, you know, took a stop, and that's it. You know?
Yeah.
13 years in heaven. That was my life.
Wow.
My dream, and, you know, I was up there, like you.
What a story. It's a great story.
Yeah, it's a true story, and, you know, it's different.
Yeah.
You know, good and bad, you know, and people might say, you know, you're a bad guy, and you did something criminal, which I did, because I got fined, you know. I was lucky not to get too much prison time, but I had a court.
Well, that's right. We didn't talk about that. So you're arrested. So you're thinking probably I'm going to be in jail for a very long time.
I thought, you know, after September 11, you know, with all the thing about aviation being very high security, I thought, you know, 10 years, 20 years, that was, you know, that was bad. I know it was going to be bad.
So how many years did you spend in prison?
Well, I was in Amsterdam for a checkup, you know, they had to check what I told them was right. So they contacted all the airlines, and of course they did all the security checks with FBI, with Scotland Yard, and, you know, I don't know, with CIA maybe. If I had any connections with terrorism, or if I was a drug dealer or whatever, and I was not. So after 2 weeks, I left the prison there, and they gave me a fine. After another month, they gave me a fine of $2,700. That was... And I could not fly for a year.
And how did they come up with that number?
I have no idea. And you know,
and you can't fly for a year.
I could
obviously
not fly, yeah, exactly. Well, as a pilot. And I did not have a license, so it was... and I think, you know, because the judge in Amsterdam said that this has never happened before. If there would be a second thing, it would be much worse. So it's a pilot case.
So technically, if you came into a huge amount of money and you wanted to go back and renew your private pilot's license and start building your license and everything, is that a possibility?
Well, you know, the thing is that the people have asked me this, and I asked myself as well, what would happen if I go to the civil aviation authorities in Italy or in Sweden with all my experience? I say, listen here, what do I need to do to get a commercial license?
Yeah.
Can I count that? Can I not count? Do I have to start from the beginning? But yes, basically, yes, I can fly.
Because there's nothing, it sounds like nothing legally preventing you from doing that.
It's strange, you know, can I count these hours that I did? As a, you know, because I did actually fly,
right.
You know, it's like strange, you know.
Yeah, it is strange.
But that's...
But I have a sense that that's not anything that's in your plans for the future.
Well, no, it is not. It's not. It's not now, it's just to get the book out.
Okay, so what would you say to the people who go, okay, well, obviously this guy did all this so that he would become famous or infamous, and he could write books and you know, have films, documentaries, done, whatever.
Well, you know, it's when I got caught, it was nothing that I imagined. I thought that people would spit on me. I thought that people, I would have a big jail, and I did not think about any of this. No, I mean, so it's nothing that I have expected, and. I don't know how successful the story will be or not, but I think it's a different story in a way, and it's a true story, and it's about passion, and it's about fulfilling your dream in a different way.
Speaking of stories, I'm sure that everybody, the first thing that pops in, at least the general public, maybe not learned aviators that listen to my show would think of, but I would imagine that a lot of people go, oh yeah, this is like the movie Catch Me If You Can.
Yeah, I heard it like 1,000 times, Catch Me If You Can too, Catch Me If You Can too. And when I was up in Hollywood, Los Angeles, 3 weeks ago, more or less, to meet a famous film producer, and the first thing he said to me was, I like your story, Thomas, because it's not Catch Me If You Can. And because the guy in Catch Me If You Can actually never flew. So I was happy that he knew that. But many people thought in the Catch Me If You Can story that the guy actually flew, but he never flew.
Well, you know what? I suppose, I mean, to me and to all of our listeners, that's obvious. I mean, all he did was ride jump seats.
Exactly.
And portray himself as a pilot, but he never actually flew an airplane.
Exactly.
But you did.
So that's a difference.
Wow. Okay. Well, is there anything else you'd like to say before we end the interview?
I'm happy that you to be here with you, definitely.
Oh, yeah. I'm so happy that you contacted me
We're
had a chance
in
to meet you. It was... And I'm sure that this is going to be an interesting interview for my listeners.
See how many throws eggs on
me. Well, we'll see. We'll see what the reactions are. And then probably I'm going to get a lot of people who are going to say, well, Captain Jeff, why didn't you ask him this and ask him that? And, you know, it was... I'm sorry if I didn't ask the right questions, but I tried to think of everything. And, again, thank you for agreeing to meet with me and talk to me. And forward to... seeing what is on the horizon for you in the future as far as books and films and that kind of thing.
I'll keep you posted.
Okay.
Thank you, Jeff.
Well, I hope you enjoyed the interview. I certainly enjoyed meeting with Thomas, hearing his story, actually meeting the person behind the hype and everything you read on the web and all that. And very nice gentleman. And little hesitant to call him the fake pilot because, for all intents and purposes, he is a real pilot. It's just that he didn't have all the required paperwork and didn't go through all the proper steps to get to where he did. And, of course, it ended up catching up with him. And as he mentioned, it's not something he recommends anybody do if you want to have a long-term career, that is. And he said many, many times during our interview and also before and after that he considers himself a very lucky person and that it could have gone much worse. He could have been sentenced for 10 or 20 years in jail. He could be, you know, there right now. So certainly the point of the interview and his message to us is not to condone what he did because he does have remorse for it. And Anyway, I just thought it was an interesting story. And the reason why I'm reluctant to call him a fake pilot is that I look at it the same way as, let's say there's a person who's a very talented person who wants to become a doctor, a surgeon perhaps, maybe a heart surgeon, something like that, brain surgeon, maybe goes to college, maybe not, claims that he has a medical school degree and all the proper training, ends up working for many, many years, like 13 years, as a successful brain surgeon or heart surgeon, whatever, and then finally it catches up with him, and people discover that he really didn't have all the credentials he said he had. But was that doctor still a good doctor, a successful doctor? I'd say probably so. So that's my two cents regarding that. During the interview, while it was playing, I met my co-pilot, Terry, and we went downstairs and went over to the Reading Terminal Market. Now, the hotel that I'm staying in, as I mentioned at the beginning of the show, is the Marriott Hotel, and the Marriott property is right next door to what used to be the Pennsylvania Reading Terminal. I think they called it the Reading Terminal Head Building or something like that. The building that is attached to the actual terminal, which I'm looking at right out this window here, what I'm looking at out the window is what they call the shed, and it had 13 tracks, and this is the big, you know, terminal for the train service here in Philadelphia. I think they opened it up in the 1890s, and then the last train left the station in 1984, at which point the city decided to renovate the property. And this building, which I'm in right now, used to be the railroad company offices. It's a very ornately styled building called the, or in the Italian Renaissance style, I think. I'm not sure. I'm not an architect. But the rooms are beautiful, really high ceilings, beautiful windows, just a kind of a cool place. So I was reading a little bit about the history of the Reading Terminal and the associated market connected to it. And that's where we went to have our late lunch or early dinner or whatever you want to call it. Had a great pastrami sandwich. So, just to kind of keep you up to speed. So I'm back, and I am going to try to knock out some more feedback. I'm going to kind of mix it up with some recent feedback that I received, most of it audio, as well as some of the email feedback that I received a while back. For instance, this one from PJ in Houston. He says, I need to just make notes through your episodes of points I want to make and just write you a big email at the end. But then again, that's how I wind up sending you 7 minutes of voice feedback. Anyway, in response to your UK listener who did the really awesome sounding flight around the San Francisco Bay Area, there have been instances where a lowly private pilot was tapped to work the radios when one of the pair up front became incapacitated. Most recently was a Continental flight a few years before the United merger, when a captain on a 757 had a heart attack and sadly passed away on a flight from Houston down to Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. The first officer issued a call for any pilots who might be on board, and a private pilot stepped up and sat up front to work the radios and help run checklists while the first officer flew the plane and diverted to McAllen, Texas. And then he gives me a link to the story in the aviationpros.com website, entitled Albuquerque Man Helped Co-Pilot Land Continental 757. I don't know if I go that far, but anyway, like the gentleman from the UK, I don't wish ill on anyone, and also like him, least of all, the people I'm entrusting my life to, but I always try to wear an aviation-themed t-shirt when I fly that identifies me as a pilot to the cabin crew. I also, just for my own fun, have a logbook that I ask the cockpit crew to fill out and sign for each flight that I'm a passenger on. I drop it off in the cockpit while boarding and retrieve it while disembarking. I have a note in the front cover explaining what the book is for, in which I just happen to mention that I'm a private pilot. Not specifically for the purpose of letting them know I'm available in an emergency, but they know I'm there nonetheless. I think most private pilots secretly dream of this occurring. Notice I didn't say hope. Some, like your fellow aviation podcaster Stephen Tupper, a.k.a. Stephen Force, from the Airspeed podcast even use the hashtag #HaveTheFish anytime they post that they're boarding a human mailing tube in reference to the aviation classic Airplane. And you'll remember in the movie Airplane, where the folks that had the fish were the ones that got sick. And of course, both pilots ended up eating the fish entree, and that's why Ted in the back, and I think it was Ted, wasn't it? And his girlfriend or ex-girlfriend, the flight attendant, went up front and basically saved the day. A spoof on a lot of those Airplane movies in the 70s. And by the way, I had somebody send me some feedback. I don't know if I've read that yet. I don't think I have. Asking me a question about the feasibility of some of the things he saw in Airport 75. And I barely remember anything about that movie. So, but anyway, I'll tackle that in a future episode. Okay, so a little side note for your listener from the UK or any other private pilots that happen to travel for business. A new service launched yesterday called Open Airplane that allows pilots to get one standardized checkout on an aircraft type that will then permit him or her to rent that aircraft type from any other participating flight school, flying club, or FBO in the country. Typically, if a pilot wants to rent from a different place, they have to first fly with an instructor and get checked out at that place, which can cost a couple hundred dollars and eat up half of your day before you're allowed to just go up and fly the aircraft type you have flown hundreds of hours in. Also, many places have rules that if you don't fly with them within 3 months, you need to repeat this checkout, which is not good if you have a repeat business destination that you only get to every 6 or 12 months. Now, with this new service, after getting your checkout, renting a plane can be as easy as renting a car. It's free for pilots to join this service, and they launched with 6 flight schools in 6 different U.S. cities. But my understanding is that they have verbal agreements from a few more and over 50 other schools in the pipeline. I encourage your private pilot or any private pilot to go join Open Airplane, even if you don't travel. If multiple schools near you participate, you can have your pick of a variety of planes at different schools and airports instead of relying on the one or two of your favorite type at your normal rental location being available when you want to fly. Check it out at it's openairplane.com. Just go there. And I'll have a link to that in the show notes. And I just happen to have it queued up in my Chrome browser. Let's see, Open Airplane. Come on. There we go. Renting airplanes just got better. It's free to join. And it goes on to explain, as PJ did in his email feedback, about how the whole system works. And so why don't you go over there and check it out as well. Again, I'll have the link in the show notes. Thank you, PJ, for that that tip for folks that rent airplanes. Now, let me address, let me go back here to the first part of your email. Oh, regarding the possibility of folks being used to work the radios or whatever. I, after reading this and other emails like this, PJ, asked some on some of my flights or some of my trips, my co-pilots, you know, what would you do? You know, I become incapacitated. Would you make a call for somebody to come up and help? And every single one of them said, no, I just, you know, work the radios and fly the airplane myself. There's really no need for anybody to come up here to help. And I tend to agree with them. I'm sorry. Especially in today's environment with opening up the cockpit door, et cetera, you never know when perhaps the incapacitation of your crew member was somehow caused by or instigated by a terrorist action or whatever. I know that's far-fetched, but I think I know that everybody I fly with, they are perfectly capable of doing absolutely everything themselves. It's just that we have two of us up there to help spread the load so we can work more flights per day. And just in case one of us is incapacitated, the other can take over and do all the duties necessary to get the airplane safely on the ground. I do appreciate your feedback, though, PJ, as always. Okay, Oh, let's do this. And this episode of the Airline Pilot Guy Show is brought to you by Deschutes Brewery Fresh Squeezed IPA, India Pale Ale, my favorite style. And I figured, you know, as long as I'm here in Pennsylvania, why not get a local... Oh, wait a minute. This is Bend, Oregon. Never mind. Oh, well. I didn't see any local Philadelphia or Pennsylvania beers that were available at that particular market. All right, back to the show. This is from Andrew. He says, hope you're well. I've appreciated your advice a few episodes ago about dealing with turbulence in flight. I've now flown aboard an A380 to and from Frankfurt. I did enjoy flying on board and just how quiet and powerful the plane feels from a passenger's point of view. The sound of the engines actually excited me about flight again, and the smooth climb in flight, even in turbulence. However, the flight from Singapore to Adelaide aboard the Singapore Airlines A330-300 was initially very bumpy around Indonesia. Your advice, Captain Jeff, and a few Baileys on ice made it a progressively smoother flight. What did surprise me was the speed the Airbus A330-300 was able to attain over Australia. We had a tailwind of about 290 to 300 kilometers per hour and coasted at a top speed of about 1080 kilometers per hour. And he enclosed a couple of photos that he took with his phone, I believe. He said, sorry, it's blurry, something to do with Bailey's. I didn't think a commercial jetliner was able to attain such speeds. So, was it a safe speed? Was the readout accurate? It was an amazingly smooth flight over Australia, and we landed 45 minutes early because of it in thick fog at Adelaide International. And again, looking at the photos that he sent, which are clear enough, I can read them. You're traveling at 39,000 feet. 672 miles per hour was the ground speed with a 173 mile per hour tailwind. And... No, you know, the speed, the only speed that the airplane cares about is the airspeed, the actual speed flowing over its wings. The tailwind is just like a stream of air up there, like a current in a river. And so a boat on a rapidly moving river only knows how fast it's going in reference to the water surface it's on. But if you're standing on the shoreline and you watch the boat, it looks like the boat is going a lot faster because it's going along with the current. That would be the ground speed. And the opposite, of course, is true. That same boat may be trudging through the water at 10 knots. If the current is 5 knots, then it looks like the boat is just barely moving. Same thing with airplanes. That's why when we plan our flights, we try to plan them so we can either take advantage of a tailwind or avoid a strong headwind if we're going the opposite direction. And I've mentioned in previous episodes that when I used to fly from Atlanta to Hawaii or Dallas to Hawaii or whatever, the routing would sometimes significantly change from week to week, dependent upon the wind patterns and the weather systems, of course. But 1 week we might be leaving Atlanta, heading through Texas, through southern Texas, maybe even through Mexico, over the Gulf of California, over Baja, Mexico, and coming at the islands from that direction. And maybe the next week, because of the wind patterns, we may be going almost due north, heading up way over the top of the Midwest, and maybe even a little bit into Canada, before heading out over the northern Pacific, and then coming into the Hawaiian island chain from the north. So again, it all depends upon the wind patterns and trying to avoid the strong headwinds in that case. And then, of course, on the way back, the dispatchers would try to find, working with meteorology, the best place to take advantage of a strong tailwind. So Nothing wrong with that. You know, I'm having this deja vu moment again where I feel like I may have already answered this question from Andrew. And if I have, bear with me. Let me down easy, please. Don't slap me down too hard if I've already talked about this. Okay. This is from Pasadena Brian, one of the many, many Brians out there. He says, "Dear Jeff, because you haven't talked about the 787 enough in the past few months, here is yet another headline for the 787. And this one deals with a diverted Dreamliner. And this was sent to me back June 24th. So this was a while ago. I don't remember the specific instance. He said, just wondering, if the pilots are uncomfortable over the battery fix, could they be making more over these recent issues than they might with other aircraft? That's possible. I'm not suggesting that they are making up incidents to have the FAA take a harder look at the 787 and keep it in the news, but I'm wondering if they are giving these new issues special attention or if they are being more conservative in their response to these issues. Again, it's a possibility, Brian, I don't know, may or may not be. It also may be that because the 787 has drawn so much attention and people are really paying attention to it, that these events, if it had been in any other airplane, may have been completely ignored or at least not much attention given to them. He goes on, as a captain, would you be able to refuse to fly the 787 because you were not happy with the battery fix, or would you have to fly it and come up with other reasons to keep the plane on the ground? Okay, now I sound like a conspiracy theorist, which I'm not. Okay. Let's say that Acme Airlines flies the 787. I've been trained on it. I'm qualified to fly it. And we're only qualified to fly. It's easy. No, it's not easy for me to say that. One type of an airplane at a time, at least with most of the major airlines that I'm aware of. So now we're having all these problems with the 787. Do I go to the chief pilot and say, oh, by the way, I refuse to fly that airplane? I think that the chief pilot would probably say, well, Jeff, it looks like you may be sick and you're going to start using your sick leave balance. And then when you run out of that, I don't know what you're going to do because you're not going to get paid until you are able to switch to another airplane and, fly that. And we do that, at least with Acme Airlines. I'm not sure about all the other airlines, by advanced entitlement. And yeah, I think that's it. That's the way that the company projects or states or puts out there that we have a vacancy in certain airplanes because of retirements or whatever. We may have a surplus of pilots or staffing on this particular airplane. So those folks, you better put in your preferences for what other airplane you may like to fly or maybe some other base. It's basically the way we either advance in our career by perhaps flying a bigger airplane with a higher pay rate. It may be our way to transfer from a base to another base. It may be our way to upgrade from first officer to captain on a particular airplane. The downside of an advance entitlement is that it likely will have surpluses or displacements where people are either asked voluntarily to or mandatorily displaced or pushed off the airplane. And that has happened to me, actually twice, but one time I was reinstated before I had to go to training. I was a co-pilot on the 727. I was being displaced because of too many people in that category or perhaps people coming in on top of me and pushing me off. And I was supposed to go fly the L-1011 as a flight engineer. I had great denial, and long story, I won't go into it. Anyway, about a week or two before my training was supposed to occur, I got a call that said, hey, your training is canceled because you have been reinstated as a 727 co-pilot. The second time I was displaced, I wasn't so lucky, I actually got displaced. And that was when I was a 727 captain. Of course, we were retiring the 727 fleet. Everybody knew it was a matter of time, even the most senior people on the category, that they were going to have to go and fly some other airplane. And I was the second group of captains that were bumped off the 727. And The airplane to which I was bumped is the airplane that I've been flying for about 12 years, the MD-88 and now the MD-90 as well, all the same category. So, well, I got off track, didn't I? So, regarding Pasadena Brian's question about what do you do when you don't want to fly it, you know, there's really not much you can do. You're going to have to suck it up and go fly it. Are some of these people flying the airplane a little bit sensitive about things and maybe overreacting a little bit? It's quite possible. I can't say for sure. I don't know. But I can tell you what, if I were flying that airplane, I would not be very happy about the fix or solution to basically enclosing a battery that could possibly still go into thermal runaway, especially when you're flying a very long-range airplane somewhere out in the middle of nowhere with very few options if something does go wrong. So that's my two cents. Moving on quickly. How are we doing here? That's not bad. Someone sent, let's see, Dean sent this to me. Dean is, I'll just start from the beginning. I found your podcast about a month ago while browsing through iTunes. I've always had a fascination with airplanes, so I thought hearing what goes on your side of the door would be interesting, and so far you have done an excellent job. I work at the FAA in Oklahoma City. Ooh, I better be careful, right? Have the FAA watching and listening to me now. And every morning we receive a newsletter with aviation-based news in it. Usually these are smaller headlines that most people would not hear unless they lived locally near said incident. Below, I have attached a link to one that I thought was rather humorous. I heard you say that it is the captain's responsibility to know how big his airplane is and to maneuver it accordingly. My question is, what will happen to the pilot from this article? Will he be suspended, or is this sort of thing more commonplace than I think? And he says, thanks for the great podcast, and if you're ever in the Oklahoma City area, I will gladly buy you a coffee or an adult beverage of your choice. And this is from Dean. Thank you, Dean. The article to which he was referring actually came from the BostonHerald.com, but it was about an incident that, believe it or not, I didn't hear anything about until I got that information from you. And as you mentioned, you know, likely you're not going to hear about the incident unless you live in the area. This happened in DCA, Washington National, and an airplane, I believe it was from another company, Delta Airlines, that was taxiing to the runway and apparently cut short a turn from one taxiway to another and ended up dragging a main gear tire in the mud, and it kind of sank down about 12 inches. They had to get buses and had to get everybody off, and they had to tow it out of the spot. Now, it was tough because I was looking at this photo, trying to figure out exactly where that occurred at National, and it was very, very difficult for me to figure it out. But I think I finally, after much research, spotted the area at which the MD, I think it was an 88 or a 90, ended up going off the taxiway. And the fillet, which is what we call the area of taxiway, rounded like a shoulder, when a taxiway makes a transition to another taxiway or a runway. And so the radius of that fillet is changes depending on the particular layout of the taxiways and runway. And this was kind of a pretty sharp turn. And the fillet area of this particular turn was narrower or not as large as if he had made a left turn at that same intersection. And apparently he didn't use enough oversteer, by which I mean having the nose wheel go further out onto the perpendicular or next taxiway and swinging it around to make sure that that main landing gear does not get into or get off of the prepared surface. One of the things that we have to be careful with on the MD-88, MD-90 series airplane is that it has a very long wheelbase. the distance from the main landing gear to the nose gear is very similar to the distance of a lot of the very much larger airplanes, the jumbo jets, etc. Whereas on the Airbuses, the narrow-body Airbuses like the 319, 320, 321, the wheelbase is much shorter. So the track of the nose wheel and the main landing gear is very, very similar. But I have to drive the MD-88, MD-90 around almost like I'm, you know, steering a 747 or a 757 or a 767 on the ground. So I have to use a lot of oversteer if I'm making sharp turns. Because again, if you don't do that, it's kind of like pulling a trailer. If you don't make a wide enough turn, you're going to end up dragging the wheels of the trailer off of the pavement. And that's what happened in this case. So his question was, what will happen to the pilot from this incident? It all depends. The company will, you know, look at the, or the FAA will look at this, and the company will look at it and decide whether or not there was a reason to perhaps give the pilot some time off. Probably not likely. I would imagine that unless there was something happening that was negligent, like he was texting on a cell phone or something like that. In that case, of course, I think that he'd probably be fired. But I think it was just a matter of not using enough oversteer. Perhaps they'll give him some extra training by putting him in the simulator and completely wasting time, simulator time, on taxiing, because let me tell you, the simulator is not a good vehicle or a good training tool to teach how to taxi an airplane. But that may be something that happened in this instance. I don't know. Don't know any of the details. So, but I doubt that there will be anything severe that happens to that person. Is that sort of thing commonplace or more commonplace than I think? It just depends on how serious a matter the incident or accident is. A lot of times the FAA will put pressure upon the company to do something. And a lot of times, especially at ACME, the company will try to ensure that something is done and that the situation is rectified and the person will get training or whatever is necessary to not do it again and hopefully satisfy the FAA. And then everybody says, okay, that's good. Let's move on with something else. So I hope that was a sufficient answer, Dean. Appreciate you listening. Don't listen too closely, especially if I say anything bad about the FAA. But you know, the FAA is a big bureaucracy. And I don't necessarily mean that in a bad way. There are good parts and bad parts and good people and bad people, and which is true with pretty much everything, isn't it? So I'm sure that whatever area that you work in is are the good people. Just kidding. We're here to help, right? Okay. And moving on very quickly. And you're saying, well, if you're going to move on quickly, why are you playing music? That is a good question. So I'll stop playing music. This is from Carson. Hello, Captain Jeff. I've been listening to your podcast for quite some time now and truly enjoy each and every second of each episode. Wow. Thank you, Carson. I've learned so much from the pilot's perspective and point of view from you. I had a quick question, though. I'll be flying a major airline next month. Let me see, when did he send this to me? 6/25. Carson, I'm sorry, you probably have already flown, because now it's August 2nd, I think. Anyway, he's flying a major airline in July and wondered if airlines still carry the airline pilot wing pins, as I would love to pick one up as a souvenir. Does your legacy airline still carry them that you know of? Yes, they do. For a while, they stopped because they had a pin on it, and you could do a lot of damage with that pin, like, you know. But they've come back. They finally decided that maybe terrorists would not use pilot wings, plastic pilot wings, to try to hurt or kill us. Sorry for the random and odd question, though. As always, keep up your outstanding work and clear skies ahead. Thanks, Carson. And again, I do apologize for not getting to your question in a more timely manner. I hope that your trip was great. Whatever legacy airline you flew on, I hope that they had the wings. I do know that the Acme does have those wings again. In fact, at Acme, we have pilot versions of the plastic wings, which are gold, and flight attendant versions of the wings, which are silver. So I would have said to you, if you still had not left for your trip and you're flying for or on Acme, I would say, I would ask the flight attendants if they had any wings, and I would ask them to ask the pilots, or even ask the pilots as you're coming on or leaving, if they had any stashed away somewhere. And they did issue some to me quite some time ago, and I ran out of them quite quickly. And so I probably need to make a note somewhere for me to go into the chief pilot's office and see if they have any more of those plastic pilot wings. So there you have it. All right. I'm going to now move over to some of my audio feedback that I've received recently. And in no particular order, let's just start with my good friend from Down Under, Irk.
G'day, Captain Jeff. It's Irk from Australia, your friendly subway driver. Sitting here in a airline lounge at Sydney Airport, just waiting to head up to the Gold Coast for the weekend. Rather looking forward to your arrival in September and also my re-arrival into the US in January. That should be rather, rather cool. Anywho, just thinking about airline operations and whatnot, I know that they have standby pilots and standby flight attendants. I know some standby flight attendants call that airport appreciation days. But I was wondering if carriers such as Acme had planes on standby. You know, not planes that are in the hangar undergoing maintenance or anything, but planes that, in the event of a big delay, they can get it towed to a gate, put a standby crew on it, and send it off somewhere. Anyway, I'm enjoying the show. I'm also enjoying this lounge thing. I don't know how long it's been going on for, but it's great. And keep up good work, and happy flying.
Well, thank you, Irk, for your feedback again. And regarding my trip to Australia coming up in September, well, change of plans. Turns out that the organization for which I was working and being a big part of, I ended up kind of stepping down from that position, and turns out that my trip to Australia had to be scrubbed. So unfortunately, I'm not going to make it out to Sydney or Melbourne or New Zealand, and I'm sad. But maybe some other time I can head out that way and meet some of my listeners. We'll have a APG meetup somewhere over there. I know that's a big territory, especially Australia, large, you know, continent. But anywho, I hope to get out there sometime again and meet some of you in person. Now, regarding airport standby, and we call it airport appreciation visits when we have a trip that you get in from a place and you go to usually a crew base and sit around for 2.5, 3, 4 hours at a time before you move on, which is very tiring, by the way. And so we're not really considered officially on standby, although they could use us if they needed to, if they could contact us, that is. But your question regarding airplanes, are there airplanes set aside specifically for standby? And I don't think so. I think that in this case, it's just airplanes that aren't being used in the schedule at the time. Could be that they were over, as you mentioned, in the hangar, or at least parked in front of the hangars, and perhaps in for something insignificant where they can put into service quickly without any problems. Perhaps Mike or Tom, my dispatcher friends at the company, could answer this question. They may actually know the official answer to this question. But I don't think, as far as I know, I don't think we have any set aside, especially for the purpose of replacing an airplane that may become broken or have some kind of a mechanical problem. So, and what was the last thing you said? I don't remember now. Well, I'm glad you were enjoying the airport lounge, and give me a, let me know when you're back in the States, and maybe this time we can arrange some kind of a meeting. Thanks again, Eric, for your commentary, as always. It's always interesting. How about, my fresh squeezed IPA wants to come up for air, apparently. A lot of carbonation in it. Let's talk to another, or let's hear from another one of the Bryans.
Hello, Captain Jeff. It's Brian from Houston, one of your mini Bryans. Thinking about changing my name to something else, but right now I'm Brian. My question, I just listened to your latest podcast, and you're talking about automation. And as you recall, I'm a automation consultant to oil and gas industry and deal with automation and other aspects. And I agree with your assessment that automation is a tool that needs to be used properly, and you should not be able, you should be able to do your job without the automation. And we were actually discussing this the other day with some coworkers, with somebody that is working in a refinery, and he has, there's a similar problem that's also happening along with automation, is everything is becoming more procedure driven, where if something goes wrong, you grab the procedure sheet and you go, okay, step one, I do this and this happens. Step two, I do this and this happens. And what they've started to discover is they'll get to a step and, well, it doesn't match procedure, and people, they don't, they have a hard time figuring out what do you do next. It's the procedure, it doesn't cover that exact scenario. And I was wondering if you're seeing this, anything similar like that in the airline industry, because I know they, you have a lot of procedures when things go wrong. If you have a similar issue of not people not being able to think outside the box when the situation does not exactly follow the procedure. So, and that's, like I said, that's a corollary to the automation problem, I think. I think it's all along the same lines. Have a good day, and I hope to hear from you. Bye.
Well, thanks, Brian. Don't do something like changing your name. Of course, you probably mean you're changing your name when you send feedback to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, right? So don't do anything, you know, extreme, please. And Brian from Houston works fine for me. Automation, yes. It's a great tool. You're right. And really what you're pointing out is, you know, the procedural driven workplace. You know, the workplace that I work in is a procedural driven workplace. And when we encounter a problem, we refer to our QRH, or Quick Response Handbook, or that's probably not the right name for that thing, but Quick Reference Handbook, whatever, our emergency checklists. And we start running checklists, and we look at, okay, this is, this light's on. Look up this light. What do we do? Step one, do this. Step two, do that. And that in itself is not always an easy thing to do, because the way checklists are written sometimes are confusing. It's sometimes easy, especially in the heat of the moment, or heat of the battle, to actually misread the checklist, or perhaps try to rush through it and then end up skipping a step or going to the wrong place in the checklist and then getting yourself into even more trouble. But if you follow a checklist methodically and you do everything correctly, there is a chance that it may not fix the problem, or there may be a chance that there's something going on that the people that created the checklist hadn't thought of. It could be that you may have multiple scenarios happening at once. For instance, the Qantas flight, the Super Airbus 380. By the way, I'm reading the book, QF, whatever the flight number was. I've only gotten to the through the first few pages of it. I really need to kind of buckle in and really read the thing. But they ended up with the losing the turbine section of the number 2 engine, I believe, that basically disintegrated and caused a big hole and tore with it many of the systems of the airplane. They ended up having multiple indications of problems. And here's the problem that I have with a fully automated airplane. In a situation like this, a computer would basically just shut down because it wouldn't know exactly how to handle all of these things simultaneously. That's why it takes a human brain to, as you said, think outside the box, to start to kind of take a few steps back and say, wait a minute, this is because of this, and this is because of this, and now I need to prioritize the problems that I'm encountering here to come up with a solution that is safe. And that is why you cannot, without intelligence, and perhaps even artificial intelligence, you have to have human intelligence. I wish I had a human intelligence to be able to talk, to actually look at these things in a different dimension and not just, do the checklist step by step. You have to kind of take a step back and look at the big picture. That's one thing that computers and automation have a tough time doing, to see the full picture. And that's why I think that we're never going to see, fully automated airplanes flying around without pilots in them, without humans, without intelligence. You have to be able to use the human brain to figure things out. So I think I may have gotten off track again. But your point is well made about automation in the refinery industry and other areas where automation is in heavy use. And yes, it is important that human operators, even if they're relying a great deal on automation, that they know how to operate the refinery process, the nuclear reaction facility, the nuclear power production facility when things start going wrong. They have to know what to do when the automation fails. And so I hope that there wasn't another part of that I forgot to answer. But if so, then send some more feedback. But just not too soon, because, I'm still trying to catch up on all this stuff. All right.
Hi, Captain Jeff. This is Chris from Germany. I'm pretty sure that you're getting a lot of messages regarding the crash in San Francisco. Here's one more. A crashed airplane, I saw a picture of it in the news, and they showed the interior of the airplane, and what you could see was the oxygen masks. Somehow they seemed to have been activated. And I'm not sure why, because in the moment of the crash, the airplane was already pretty much pretty close to the ground. So why are the oxygen masks there? Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Chris. I don't know. It could be that the masks deployed during the impact and subsequent pirouette of the airplane after it hit the runway, lost its tail, etc. Because I think it depends on the airplane, but the oxygen masks are held in the passenger service units above the where you sit as a passenger, and it's usually a rectangular opening, and if the plastic fascia or whatever is twisted and warped in a certain way, it's possible that this rectangular piece that covers up the oxygen masks could just fall down based on that warping. On the 727, I can tell you from my own experience that if you landed hard on that airplane and you were landing in line with the runway, so there wasn't any torsional torque or distortion of the interior of the airplane when you hit down hard, chances are you were not going to get the oxygen masks dropping, or what we call the orchard. But if the airplane, with a not even a super hard landing, if you were coming in, let's say you're for a crosswind, and the fuselage was not exactly aligned perfectly when you touched down, that torsion, or whatever you want to call the force, in other words, twisting of the airplane when it hits and then is straightened out, the torquing of the components, the passenger service units, would be just enough for those panels to drop, and then of course you'd have the oxygen masks hanging down, and then you'd be very embarrassed, and then somebody would have to go back and, you know, put them back up into their places. That could be what happened in the Asiana thing. It could also be that for some unknown reason somebody decided to deploy the oxygen masks from the cockpit. Again, I don't see the point of that. You're already on the ground. The oxygen masks are not for breathing in a fire. Your oxygen masks are there, the passenger masks are there for getting oxygen in case you have a rapid decompression or a depressurization incident or event. So absolutely no reason for somebody to push the button to deploy the oxygen masks on the ground. And there would be no reason to do it before they landed either. So, big question mark on that one, Chris. I don't know. I'm sure that that'll be something that will be covered in the final report of the NTSB, probably sometime around a year from now. So we'll have to check that out when that comes out, if they even mention it at all. Sorry I didn't have a definitive answer for you. And thank you, Chris, for sending the feedback. Let's see. Let's hear from Vernon.
Hi, Captain Jeff. It's longtime listener Vernon in Fort Morgan, Colorado. I just looked at the Southwest airline video thing by the passenger after the nose collapse, and I heard the audio of a flight attendant saying, "Everybody take your seats. We're not there yet." And I also remember you saying, talking about the Asiana flight to crash at San Francisco, that they were left on board 90 seconds before an evacuation order was issued. And my question to you is that something that never has occurred to me before. Who orders the evacuation of an aircraft like that? Obviously, captain can, but others can. You mentioned maybe the flight crew. Say I'm a pilot sitting in an emergency exit and see a fire outside. Can a passenger say, "There's a fire, let's get out of here," and open the nearest exit and start people exiting? So where does that authority, who has it, who doesn't have it? I'm curious to the answer to that question brought up by these two recent incidences. Thanks for a great podcast, and look forward to hearing your answer, Captain Jeff. Bye now.
Well, thank you, Vernon from Colorado. As always, appreciate your feedback and contribution to the show. And somebody else, and I was trying to quickly... actually, that wasn't your comment. Okay, never mind. Regarding evacuations, who can call for or command an evacuation? You're right. The captain can do it. In fact, it's my primary... I'm the primary person to call for an evacuation. However, there are steps in place that allow for flight attendants to call for an evacuation if they don't receive a response from the pilots. So let's say, for instance, we are incapacitated in some way and they don't get an answer from us or they don't hear from us at all, they can command an evacuation. But primarily, it is the captain's responsibility to make that call. Now, you're flying on an airplane. You just had an incident. You look out the window, and you see an engine on fire, or a wing on fire, or whatever, and you think, we need to evacuate. You have not heard the evacuation call. Yeah, you're going to probably say, "Hey, look, there's a fire. We need to get out of here." And the fact is that a lot of evacuations are are not commanded evacuations by the crew, but by the passengers. Sometimes it's a good thing. Many times it's not a good thing. It causes more problem than whatever the perceived danger is to begin with. Because you'll notice that if you keep track of airplane incidents, accidents, etc., most of the injuries caused when they have to do an evacuation are caused by the evacuation. So that's one of those things that I, as a captain, have to really, really, really think hard about. We have some kind of an event. Let's say we abort a takeoff. Okay, now, do I make the call and call for an emergency evacuation, knowing that I could get a lot of injuries, maybe even some severe, just because of the evacuation event? Or do I keep everybody on the airplane and hope that I've made the right decision and whatever it is that we aborted for is not going to cause danger or harm to my passengers? So it's a tough call sometimes, especially when we're isolated way up in the front behind this beefed up door. We don't always know for sure exactly what's happening in the back. And that's why communication is so important between the cockpit crew and the cabin crew, to let us know exactly what's going on back there so that we can make the proper decision. I chuckled because I remember back in the several years ago flying the L-1011. For those of you who have flown on the L-1011, you know this from experience, especially when it's kind of cold outside. Those big Rolls-Royce RB211 triple compressor engines take about 3 minutes to start, at least, and they I've had that on an earlier episode, the sound of these, the rumble and sound of these engines getting started. And one of the peculiarities of that engine, and I've seen it also on some of our other airplanes like the 757 on a cold day, during the start sequence, those engines really, really start to smoke. And that can kind of sometimes freak out passengers that are sitting back in the back aft of the wing-mounted engines, and they look outside and they see all the smoke just pouring out from under the wing. And there have been several instances, or there were several instances in the past, where people had decided that this is not good, and they ended up starting an evacuation on their own, an uncommanded evacuation. And again, the L-1011 sits up pretty high, and the 757 does too. And it's very, very common when you get an uncommanded evacuation by the passengers that a lot of people get injured. And so that's something that you have to keep in mind as a passenger, that if the pilots or cabin crew have not initiated the evacuation, you're probably better off just staying in your seat and waiting for instruction and not making that decision upon your on yourself. Making that decision yourself. There we go. Because it could be just something that's normal. Now, a good crew would say, conditions are just right for a smoky engine start. Perhaps a little PA right before you start the engine may be a good idea. Hey, folks, it's a cold day. This particular brand of engine in these conditions, sometimes, not always, but sometimes when we start them up, a lot of gray smoke starts pouring out of these things. And that's normal. Expect to see that. And don't initiate an evacuation, please. So those little types of communications to passengers, listen, pilots, can be very, very important and really cuts down on the paperwork, if you know what I mean. All right. Thank you, Vernon, again, for your feedback. And let's go with this.
Hey, I love your show. I just found out about it. Somebody sent me through a Catholic pilot to check you out. You're excellent. I have a quick question. I live in New York, New York City, actually, and I'm looking to start flying. I'm 55, but I'm in a wheelchair. I was wondering if there's any information. Basically, I would need issues. I have issues with using a rudder, the rudders I would be afraid of. I was wondering if there was any anything that you may know that may help me to bypass that obstacle. The other thing was is that check out Sherper Turbine. It's a tail dragger. It's just such a cool looking plane, fun to fly. It would make me want to fly a tail dragger. But thanks a lot. I really appreciate your show, and I hope to hear from you. Thanks.
Well, thank you, whoever you are. You didn't say who you were, what your name is. Thank you for listening. And 55, heck, I'm 54. Coming up, I'm 55 in December. So, hey, we're about the same age, and we're not old. You know, it's never too late to learn how to fly. I think everybody listening who is a pilot would agree with me. So I say, go for it. Now you're thinking, okay, well, I'm in a wheelchair. What's the feasibility of that? Well, I thought to myself, I smiled actually when I was listening to you, and I thought, you know, I remember listening to an episode, and I mentioned this podcast in a previous, actually, the podcast that I listened to is the Airplane Geeks, and in it, they have a certain section of the show that they devote to the folks that run the Plane Crazy Down Under podcast, PCDU, and they have their own separate podcast, the Plane Crazy Down Under podcast. In their episode number 108, they did a piece on a quadriplegic who is going to be flying around the entire continent solo around Australia. Yes, you heard me correctly, a quadriplegic. And let's hear a little bit from an excerpt from that show.
I think it'd be true to say that for most of us who are aviators, we've all had some various challenges that we've all had to overcome during the course of our training and so on, and our guest this week is certainly no exception to that. However, this individual has had to overcome some especially unique challenges in this regard, not only in the process of learning to fly, but learning to do so despite some significant physical disabilities. Well, he's now an accomplished private pilot, and he's about to embark on his next big challenge, and that's to become the first quadriplegic to fly solo around Australia. I'm speaking, of course, of Mr. David Jacker, and he joins us on the line now. G'day, Dave. Welcome to the show.
Thanks to be here. Thanks, Grant and Steve. It's, much appreciated.
Well, Dave, it's certainly an epic flight that you've got coming up, and one that's certainly had the interest of many of our listeners. We've received many emails.
Okay, that's just a little taste of the episode. I'll have a link to it in the show notes. And that, again, that's the Plane Crazy Down Under podcast, episode 108, entitled On a Wing and a Chair. And the reason why they use that as their title is that David Jacka, the gentleman with quadriplegia, has a website on a wing and a chair, and it talks about his plan to fly solo around Australia. Also on his website, there are a couple of videos that you might want to look at. And so I think this is just the ticket to get your motivation up. Now, as far as flying a tail dragger, tail draggers require, I mean, all small airplanes, general aviation airplanes, do require a certain amount of rudder pedal usage to fly coordinated turns and that type of thing, much more so than the use of rudder pedals on jet aircraft. Now, a tail dragger even requires more skills and more work using that rudder, not only for coordinated turns, but also when you land. It's very important that you have good skills with the rudder. And I think those of you listening who are tail dragger pilots would agree with me. I don't have a lot of experience in a tail dragger, like basically zero. I have flown in a tail dragger airplane, but it was only basically as a passenger, not at the controls. But I understand it's quite challenging. So I think you should go for it. I think you should listen to the show, perhaps seek some flight instructors where you live in New York, see if they've ever dealt with anybody with your particular disability, to see if it's something that is promising. And you may even want to, you know, refer them to this gentleman and the Plane Crazy Down Under podcast, episode 108, etc. And go from there. I think the sky is the limit, so to speak. And good luck to you. And please, if you do pursue this, next time you send some feedback, let me know who you are so we can learn more about you, and let us know how your journey to learn how to fly with your particular limitations, how that's going. And as always, appreciate your listening. Okay. How about one more piece, at least one more piece of feedback.
Hi, Captain Jeff. I finally got around to recording some voice feedback. Last week, I was on final approach into JFK while listening to APG-73. We landed safely despite this, where you were talking about the near miss in this airspace. So, my question is, why don't the air traffic control at JFK and LGA communicate? I'm sure there are other times when unreported incidents have happened over this airspace. If a flight is operating from, for argument's sake, JFK, LAX, JFK, which base is the crew from? From JFL to LAX, the crew should be JFK based, but this crew has to get back to JFK. But on the other hand, since the return flight is from LAX, shouldn't it be the LAX based crew operating the flight? This scenario would be applicable if the flight was operated by, say, American Airlines, who has bases at both of these airports. It surprises me that you are looking forward to using iPads for your charts instead of sleeping a case of papers around. I know your views on automation. While it's good, the fear is that pilots are becoming more and more reliant on it. While unlikely, it is still possible that both iPads can crash. What would happen then if there are no paper landing charts? Also, you mentioned that the iPads have an extra battery attached to them to extend the battery life on longer flights. Why wouldn't the airlines just install a USB port so there would be a continuous supply of power to the unit instead of relying on batteries? Look at the 787. Any insight to any of these points would be most appreciated. As always, thanks for an awesome podcast. Hope your mum is doing well, Peter.
Thanks, Peter, for your feedback. And I hope that I remember all the questions you just asked, because I didn't write down the notes. Number one, why don't the controllers between John F. Kennedy and LaGuardia communicate? I think they do. It's just that it's not a constant communication. And in the case of the near miss that we talked about on an earlier episode over there, it was one of those things that required urgent and immediate communication between the two controlling airports, and apparently they didn't have anything set up for that. And I can bet, or bet you, that they're looking at something that will prevent that from occurring again. And if so, they'll have maybe enhanced communications in place to so that they can talk to each other very, very rapidly. But good question regarding that. Number two, you talked about the hypothetical John F. Kennedy to Los Angeles, and you said, you know, obviously the flight from John F. Kennedy to Los Angeles would be from a John F. Kennedy based crew. Well, no, it's not obvious. In fact, crews flying that type of flight, an intercontinental flight, could be based in Atlanta, based in Miami, based in Dallas. It could be that as part of their trip, they would fly from Dallas to New York, maybe layover, the next day, New York to Los Angeles, then layover, Los Angeles, back to John F. Kennedy in New York the next day, etc. It could be a crew from any crew base. It's just, I know you think that if the flight originates in New York, that it's being flown by a New York-based crew. But, and that's probably likely, but chances are, I mean, I fly to New York all the time, and fly flights that originate from New York to South Florida and other places around the country. And I'm based in Atlanta. So it doesn't always, what happens is marketing comes up with this plan and all these flights and the airplanes they're going to use for the flights. And each crew base has a certain listing of the pilots available to fly that particular airplane, the flight attendants that are available to fly that trip. They put all this information into this big, giant supercomputer, and it chugs and chugs and chugs, and it comes out with all these different scenarios and tries to most efficiently match the flights and the crew, the cabin crew and the pilot crews together to make best use of its crew resources. And that's how trips are constructed coming from the output from this computer system. And then each crew base gets a list of the requirements, and then they put that out for a bid, and then we, the crew members, look at it and say, oh, that flight or that trip leaves on Monday, the blah, blah, blah. That looks like a good trip. I'll bid for that. So that's how the whole, I mean, in a nutshell, how everything works. So I hope that answers your question about the crews that fly these particular flights. Again, just because it's leaving from a hub doesn't mean that it's being flown by that hub's crew. iPads. You talked about how it's a great idea to use these things, and I agree. I think that iPads will be used eventually by all airlines because it's a lot less weight, and I think eventually it will be cheaper, or maybe right off the bat it's cheaper for the airline than to have all these subscriptions to the Jeppesen or government charts. You said it's possible for both of these iPads to fail. Probably, you're probably more likely to get hit by lightning than for two iPad or tablet devices to fail simultaneously. But let's just say, for instance, that it did happen. What would happen at that point, especially if you're not carrying backup paper approach plates, charts on the airplane? And I believe that American Airlines does not, I think they have authorization to not have any of those backup paper plates on board the airplane. Well, if you still have radio communications, you just call up the people and say, hey, look, believe it or not, both of our iPads just died, and we don't have the information for the instrument landing system for this runway at your airport. Could you please give it to me? And they say, sure. The frequency is 108.5. The course is 275. The minimum descent altitude is 200 feet or 1,200 feet. The missed approach procedure is blah, blah, blah. And basically, they give you all the information that's necessary to fly these approaches. That happens not quite often, but on occasions where people are diverted into different airports and they don't have that information on board the airplane. So they get the information from the controllers, the air traffic controllers. They have all that information available to them. Okay, so the scenario is we lose both iPads and you lose all your radio communications. Well, I think you're probably, it's just not your day. Bad day. Don't know what to do at that point. Anyway, good question though. You asked why. Because they talked about having a backup battery. I think the American Airlines solution is to have a 60 kilowatt per hour battery backup that will power an iPad for 24 hours or whatever. And why don't they just have USB ports installed or some kind of a power outlet installed? I think it has to do with money and certifying all the new wiring and electronic whatever. I think it's just a matter of a time it takes to do that, retrofit, and again, the money required to make all that happen. And when you can successfully run these things without having to install a dedicated power outlet, I think the airlines are going to do that because, you know, they're all about making money. They're not charities. So that would be my answer to that. Now, if somebody out there has a better answer, let me know. Send some feedback and let us know. But as far as I know, that's probably why these things don't have any kind of a hardwired interface to the electronics in the airplane or don't have some kind of a USB port or some kind of a power port to plug the things in. Let's see. By the way, a nice video from, I think, Jeff Felmuth from American Airlines sent me a link to this. And this guy, and you've heard me talk about him before. His name is, he has a blog and YouTube videos. His name is Kent Ween. I hope I'm pronouncing his last name correctly. He's with American Airlines. He's a captain. And he put out that YouTube video about the MD-80 series cockpit. And so we talked about that in a previous episode. And then he also put out one about the iPad and its use inside of the MD-80 series that American flies. So if you're interested in that, check out the link in the show notes. And just in case you don't look at the show notes, I thought it was from his website, but it's actually, this is from gadling.com, Cockpit Chronicles. So just do a Google search for Cockpit Chronicles, the iPad flight bag, and you'll get a link to this article. And again, I'll have it in the show notes, make it easier on you. Okay, looking down here, I think I have all of the audio feedback that I had selected to play for today's show. Again, I went longer than I had anticipated. I always do. I apologize to every single one of you out there who prefer the short format versus long format. But I thought that the interview that I did with Thomas Salme was very interesting, and I'd like to hear your response to that. And again, I'm doing my best to catch up on all the feedback. I'm getting closer to getting caught up. And remember, if you want to send feedback, you can send it to feedback@airlinepilotguy.com. You can call up the Google Voice feedback line, which is 304-99-PILOT, area code 304, which I think is West Virginia, but I'm not there. 304-997-4568. Realize that the time limitation on that voicemail, I believe, is 3 minutes. So if you have a longer comment, don't worry. Just call back and keep talking. Go to the website, airlinepilotguy.com, and look for that tab on the right side of the screen. Send me voicemail. That's the SpeakPipe app. Functionality available on the website. Again, there is about a 3 minute time limit, I believe, on leaving feedback there. Or you can do as many have, use that smartphone. Here's mine. There's a voice memo app that comes with it, at least the iOS devices. I'm sure that the Android devices have something like that as well. Lots of great apps out there to record audio and send it to feedback@airlinepilotguy.com, and that way you won't have to worry about time limitations. So lots of ways to send me feedback, and until next time, wishing you clear skies, unlimited visibility, and tailwinds. Take care and God bless.
Good day.